I arrived from Korea a few hours ago. I'm straight from the airport. I was not supposed to come earlier, but it was one of the cases that I did not go through, so I came early. It's part of the broker's thing. Sometimes it goes through, sometimes it doesn't. And I just want, because the field is shipbuilding, and I spent the field of discussion, and I spent the last couple of months in Asia working on shipbuilding projects very intensively, I would like to share a few thoughts with you right from the source before my colleague Evdoxos goes to more pragmatic and quantifying his arguments with the presentation. I just want to touch on the point that my friend Harry made, that indeed we have been experiencing a new wave of orders the last months, which reaches the limit of a paradox, since we have a very negative market environment, and also a freight market environment and financial market environment, which one would expect that would keep the investment in the new building front low. This is not the case. Indicatively, we as Castec Nava, we are more or less focusing these days on new building. We've signed more than 30 shipbuilding contracts in 2013, and we expect that probably in Greece alone we have signed, the Greek market has been involved in 100 to 130 new building contracts, new ships, primarily dry but also products, and then in less in the specialized segments as well. A few thoughts that I think would be of some value is what triggered this paradoxical wave of new orders in this environment. My personal opinion is that it's a combination of pragmatic thoughts and also psychology factors, and a strange form of game theory between the yards and the owners on the game of where the prices will stabilize as we define it, all-time low point or lowest point, etc. So there was a point in time in early 2013 where the yards, either intentionally or in my opinion, somehow without exactly planning it, coordinated in a way that they positioned themselves that they will decrease substantially their shipbuilding capacity, and they basically managed to undercut the subcontractors to such an extent that would allow them the yearly production to go down 40-50% than the expected or the planned one. And we had the shipyards that were building 20 ships, eventually building 8. We had shipyards with 40 building 15. And this totally changed their marketing strategy, because when you have a plan as a major shipbuilding group to find 8 ships within 1 year, it is a very different game than if you need to find 20 ships. So this, in combination with some key orders by some players that are considered to be flag movers, triggered an interesting psychology game, which many owners followed. And we have a big number of orders which have also resulted to the increasing prices in new building that we are experiencing in the last months. Indicatively, the prices have increased, in my mind, 5-7%, which is contradictory to what the market indicates. And for example, the Ultramaxes were ordered early 2013 at 24 million, now it's 25.5, the Kamsarmax was 26, now it's 27, the Capes were 43-44, now they are 47-48 in equivalent yard basis. We have seen MR tankers at 30 million, we placed orders at 30 million 6 months ago, we placed orders recently at 33, as brokers meaning. So the increase is there. And it reaches the limits of a paradox in terms that we should not have this encouragement from the freight market. On the other hand, I am one of the people that support the idea that these price levels could be the lowest we will see, in terms that the yards will manage to find this critical number of 5, 6, 7, 8 ships per year that they need to survive at this price levels. Very quickly, and before I tire you, and I hope that my jet lag does not affect too much the performance of this speech, but I would like to say a few words on the three major markets, and if I could identify the most characteristic feature of China, Japan and Korea in terms of shipbuilding today. In China, we have a definite switch of appetite that after the orders of the last months, they are unwilling to take orders at the previous levels. They have, I'm talking about the 30 quality yards. The rest, they can accept anything. But the 30 quality yards, or 25, 30, 35, well, you name the number, they are unwilling to take to go along with a pushing buyer. They have more or less covered their 2015 necessity, and this makes them stronger in negotiation tables and more difficult in all fronts. I believe that even if all this dream of new orders that they have might deflate, in any case there is some inertia that will not result to a reduction of price the next 5-6 months. Even if there are not more new orders, there is some inertia, and the fact that there is covered capacity in 2015, I think that the prices will be sustained in these levels. In Korea, it is interesting, we have an absolute focus on more, as we say, on vessels with higher CGT, higher complexity, which allows them higher profit margins, or if not higher profit margins, which allows them to control it without the Chinese undercutting their price levels. Korean yards are impossible to, it's impossible to discuss with the Korean yard any dry bulk project apart from very specific cases, cape sizes. And I expect that to be sustained. We have LR2 containers, certain MRs, and then it goes to the specialized ships. This feature most likely will be maintained the next years. And of course, it's very interesting to see how Japan will develop, because with the new status that we experience in the upward trend of yen, and the expectations to become even stronger, then it makes meaning the difference with US dollar to go in well excess of 100, it remains to be seen what role it will play in the prices that they want to market. Indicatively, I want to say, when we were negotiating with a major Japanese yard, when Kamsarmax close to 30, they were explaining to us that every 3 basic points of the yen-dollar ratio is almost $1 million in the price they can quote. So it was, if the ratio went from 70 to 73, they could basically reduce or they could manage their cost with an equivalent reduction of price of nearly $1 million. In my mind, it seemed quite incredible at the time. But now that the ratio is close to 100, they explained to us that this effect is not linear. It doesn't mean that as much as it goes, they can handle their cost equivalently. So this is a very quick overview from a man that still wears Korean clothes, and I pass it on to my friend and colleague Evdoxos, that will touch these issues in a more numerical and solid basis. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you. Thank you, Fedon. I think you covered everything. Not so many things to say. Thank you very much for the opportunity you are giving us. We would like also to give more or less on what Fedon addressed a bit earlier. presentation on the global, the prospect of global shipbuilding. I will try to go very quickly in order not to tire you. The sections will be capacity and subsidies, order book, about the competition between the yards, and a few notes on the eco design. And we'll close with a few notes also on the prospects of new buildings. The big question is how much is ship building capacity? And the answer is nobody knows, because I think there is no straightforward answer to that. And builders have downsized the facilities to the absolute minimum just to maintain their production lines, because they couldn't afford taking orders at such low prices. We estimate builders' reduction on production around 30-50%. And I would like to focus very quickly in the three major shipbuilding countries, Japan, and would like to say that Japanese builders have increased dramatically their capacity during the booming years, which assisted them quite a lot not to have a problem during the crisis. And also the strong yen, the high labor cost, and the high equipment cost, which caused sorry for that. And these three factors assisted the Japanese builders to create the five biggest builders in Japan have capacity to deliver 300-350 ships, and currently are slowing down the production to 180-200 ships per year. Builders in Japan focus on developing new eco designs for dry bulkers. In South Korea, shipping crisis seriously affected Korean shipbuilding, and a number of yards are not operational anymore. The big builders in Korea mainly focused on LNG, offshore, and big container ships. Most big Korean groups have established overseas facilities in their efforts to lower their costs. Small and sized builders focused on product tankers. And we have seen, as Ferdinand said, almost zero orders for barges. In China, it is estimated that around 500 yards have been established the past 10 years, and approximately 200 of them are still active, but only 25-30 yards have taken new orders within 2012-2013. And the owners have shown trust only to the big state-owned groups, and few quality private yards have managed to attract new orders during the last 2 years. The major shipbuilding countries try to assist on the next topic, on the national service and industry policies. The major shipbuilding countries try to assist directly or indirectly the shipbuilding industry, and each country have followed a different strategy. And in Japan, they have established the JSHIP, which is the Japan Ship Investment Facilitation, and which is basically a project finance scheme. And very quickly, the general idea is that 80% will come from JBIC, which is the governmental bank, and some other financial institutions, and also 10% of equity will be provided either by the buyers or the trading houses or the builders. However, this scheme didn't have any practical application, since the due diligence that required by JBIC had been very strict and very time consuming. In Japan, what happened lately that the new government, which has been elected in December 2012, and the Prime Minister, Mr. Shinzo Abe, supported a lot the exports, and in his efforts to support the exports has printed yen, and in result the yen has depreciated significantly. We understand that the yen has been depreciated more than 20% over the past 6 months. Today, $1 is approximately 101 yen, and in October 2012, it was $79 yen. Various analysts, they expect to see $1 to 120 to 125 yen within the next until the end of 2013, beginning 2014. And we understand that Yeah. Abenomics, the so-called Abenomics, as they say in Japan, provides flexibility to the builders to lower their prices. In South Korea, support of Korean builders came from the banking system mainly, and major banks selectively supported overseas ship owners mainly for highly valued projects which offer sufficient guarantees. And in China, there were no direct subsidies by the state. However, Chinese banks have allocated for financing overseas ship owners. However, this procedure has been also been time-consuming, and in most cases, the finance cost was very high, so we didn't see many deals going through with Chinese, with direct Chinese financing, and a few projects have been materialized on a bareboat hire basis. In these cases, either leasing companies or builders themselves arrange their finance. In Tikal, I have a very small, very quickly I will show you a small example of a bareboat hire purchase scheme for an Ultramax 64,000 deadweight in China. The purchase price of 25 million, charter down payments 20%, a bareboat rate for 8 years is 7,500, and purchase obligation year 8 at 10 million. In China, a latest development that we see in China is that some design companies, in order to promote their designs, they are trying to assist the ship owners to attract, let's say, the ship owners to order in the yards, and they finance themselves the construction of the ship, and in this regard they might accept from the ship owner payment of 10% on contract and 9% on delivery. Which we haven't. This is the latest situation that we see, and it remains to see how practical, how applicable this will be. The order book we have made a small table, which is mainly for the this table is for the bulk carriers. As we see, the order book of Panamax and Kamsarmax together is around 20%. It has. It's still at relatively low levels compared to the previous years of 2008. Of the Capesize and Newcastlemax, together is around 16%, and the Handysize is around 15%. On the tankers, we see that the MRs have been at 10%. The order book, around 20% are the MRs owned by Greek owners. And on the LR2s, which we have seen later in 2013, a relative big number of orders is around 7%. On the next topic, on the competition between yards and pricing, I would like to mention that in 2013, NB prices, we have seen the prices in 2013 almost at half levels of what we have seen in 2008. And it's almost close to the level that we have seen in 2002. The prices reached a rock bottom level in the first quarter of 2013. And the main reasons have been scarce financing environment, poor charter markets, and unwillingness of builders to further reduce the prices. Chinese have stopped taking shipyards have stopped taking orders in the second half of 2012, and the weakening of yen assisted builders to reduce the required premium between China and Japan. In 2010-2012, premium required by Japanese builders compared to Chinese reached approximately 20-30%. In 2013, due to yen depreciation, the premium dropped around 10% or even lower in some cases. Indicatively, in the first quarter of 2011, we have contracted a Kamsarmax in China at USD 34 million, and in the same time in Japan, the price was 44 million. And in first quarter 2013, a Kamsarmax in China has been have reached 25.5 million, and in Japan 28.5 million. So we see that the gap has. Became much smaller. It's right now it's around 10%. I'm having here just some milestones on the prices. As we see, we are almost at the levels of 2002, and quite lower than the levels of 2010. This goes for the bulkers. Here we have the tankers, which is more or less the same situation. And also, sorry. It's like, yeah. The next one is containers. Yeah, containers. Okay. In Japan, the previous fiscal year, what we have seen and what Fevon briefly said that we have seen the first Q 2013, we have seen lower prices than what we see now, and this is a small paradox because the market don't really support this increase. We don't see higher charter rates, we don't see, let's say, an opening on the financial markets. But the previous, what, some of the reasons, let's say, that this happened, I would like to describe here. In Japan, the previous fiscal year, we said the 31st of March, and one of the reasons that Japanese accept lower prices was that for accounting reasons, they had to lower the prices to, let's say, the absolute necessary levels in order to attract orders. Also, same time, the depreciation assisted them to achieve their target, minimizing their losses. And this assisted them both to cover their immediate needs and also reduce tax by sharing forward losses with existing highly valued contracts. This is a special system, accounting system that they have in Japan. In Korea, Korean yards have attracted the majority of tankers, containers, and offshore projects. Prices hit rock bottom levels in first quarter 2013, and following the higher demand for new building projects, builders have increased their ideas. Indicatively, I would like to share some prices, like also Fevon said before. The MR tanker in Korea, in, like 6 months ago, in let's say mid 2012, was valued around 31, 32 million, and current pricing is at 34, 35 million. In China, Chinese builders have been dropping their prices constantly since the summer of 2008 until the summer 2010. This was mainly because ship owners have been afraid to proceed with further orders since the outside seem still to be quite big. However, state-owned groups in China decided last summer to stop taking any orders for conventional ships at loss-making levels. Ship owners returned to China in first quarter 13 since they felt more comfortable that prices would not drop further. And I have very quickly some indicative dry bulk new building prices. We see that also the differential, hand in China right now is around 21 million, a hand in Japan now is around 23, 24 million. The cape size in China now is around 45, 46, even 47 in some cases. And in Japan is excess 50 million. For the tankers, the price we see in Korea is around 33, 34 million. And for the LR2s, it's around 50 million. And on the containers, also we have seen a very big drop of prices. And currently, 9,000 TEU is around 82 million, and 40,000 TEU in Korea is around 107 to 110 million. I have also some few notes here on the very big topic of eco designs, and this is, let's say, the topic of the days, and the general concept is that optimization of hull lines allowed bigger diameter propellers to be installed, which consequently required lower RPM and lower power in order to achieve same speed with previous designs. And also the introduction of the G-series of MAN and also X generation of Arcila, which are basically engines with longer stroke, have assisted on further reducing the specific fuel oil consumption. And also the bigger derailed engines, which achieve 3-4% better stroke compared with the standard design. However, the shipyards right now quote specific consumptions, but are these the actual consumptions? The question is that the shipyards quote consumption on ideal conditions, which are on design draft, not scandling, calorific value of 42.7 and not 40.6, smoke basis, consumption of generators of boiler need is not included, and we estimate the consumption to be around 45 tons higher than quoted by builders for medium sizes. Let's say Ultramax, Kamsamax and the Mars. I have a small table here which shows the differentials between existing design, previous designs, let's say, and new designs. Indicatively, we see on cake sizes, daily fuel consumption from 57 is now approximately 47. For comparison purposes, here we have the calculations we have for both designs is on the design draft, see margin 15% on same speed, in order to have to be able to compare equals. And let's say, as we see on cave size, around 7,000 USD per day. And I would like to sum a few points at the end to have for the new building prospects. The new orders are mainly sentiment driven and not faith driven. This is, what we said before, is a small paradox, because we have not seen increased charter market and we have not seen let's say easy finance for the majority of ship owners. Also, the eco designs which have better consumption, compliance with new regulations and less maintenance, higher upside and downside, sea prices are almost at historical lows and expectations for better markets in 2015 and 2016. On the tankers, the good sentiment is on products. The negative sentiment on the crude MR and LR2 inquiries have increased, and crude tanker inquiries are at historical lows. Sitting of refining process in Middle East, India creates expectations for expanding ton mile on the product side, and we expect that demand for these ships will be higher. And also the shale oil reserves in US, we expect eventually that will reduce the imports of crude oil. And therefore, I think that it's one of the reasons that we'll see not so many inquiries on the crude tankers. On the container ships, the impact of new designs, I believe, is much bigger than tankers and bulkers, and this is called basically because of high speeds that have a high impact. And new designs have lower service speed, less consumption, are therefore, the builders manage to make wider ships which have a better stability, which also are able to load more homogeneous containers and increase have higher earning capacity. The expectation for 2-tier market between new design and older ones. Already we have seen some cases of new generation containers that have been gaining around 5,000 more per day. And existing designs, and also the collapse of the KHC system increased the demand for new tonnage providers, and also at the end one of the most important reasons is that new building prices now are at historical lows. And the final conclusion is to order or not to order.
Shall we proceed to the final panel for today?